Is it working? It looks like it's on. I think someone posted a comment, but it disappeared. So someone, I think, made it on here. Let's check it out. So the stream's there. Working now. Okay, cool. But for some reason, I'm not seeing the chat coming on. Weird. Okay, you know what? I'm gonna open up a new Twitch page. Oops. Let's see. Maybe we'll see the chats come up. Welcome to chat. So chat's there now. Test. I saw my message. Okay, so that should be working fine. Welcome back, gang, to session number two, I guess. Of doing a little bit of just open discussion, making myself available for anyone. Any luck? Yeah, I think we're up. I think we're up. High index. This should be working now. For some reason, it was buffering and not loading, not connecting. Perfect. Okay, sweet. That's good. Session two of a day of math, I guess we're calling this. But it's really open discussion. If there are math questions coming up, I just one thing I did was I promised when I created my Patreon page that I would make myself available for live streams for sure. And it's something that it just worked out with Patreon and live streaming sort of coming together for me. And that's sort of me giving back for people for supporting me on Patreon, on Twitch, on YouTube, wherever, right? It's just to make myself available. And initially, when I started that, when I did the Patreon, I did a post on Patreon asking the people supporting me there how they wanted to go about doing the live streams. I mentioned that we could make it private live streams for the different tiers that are supporting me. And a couple of people mentioned that I should just be true to my philosophy of doing this work, which is make it open to everyone, you know, not restrict. And I agreed with that as well. And the folks at Patreon were kind enough to be okay with it as well. So that was fantastic. And that's the, you know, a little bit more info of what's going on here, which is basically, as far as I'm concerned, I'm contracting out to people supporting me and creating my content and doing a lot of front-end work for reaping rewards in the back end of putting math content together, booklets, modules, and stuff like this. So this is part of the process of getting that done, right? Getting that done. And we'll see. We'll see how things progress. So far, so good. I do enjoy this, and I think we're having fun doing this and sharing a lot of information, which is fantastic. Which is what the internet is about, as far as I'm concerned. And again, open discussion. We can talk about almost anything you guys want. Math centric, if people have questions, have exams coming up. And since we're math centric, because on the last stream we did earlier, like an hour and a half ago or something, we ended it. We talked about the Monty problem, right? And I mentioned in that stream that we can also not necessarily just talk about schoolwork. If there's any type of data that anyone wants to look into that we can, you know, maybe political, maybe economic, maybe whatever it is, right? Something related to math in the real world, right? That's what the name of the game is, right? Learning the syntax of the language of mathematics and using in the real world, right? So keep that in mind. If there's any type of data you want to look at, maybe regarded to prohibition laws, incarceration, maybe to health related stuff, maybe to athletics, right? If you're training, if you want to look at graphs and stuff, try to make sense of it all, right? All of that is open. This is not necessarily just high school math. This is math, right? And to the best of my abilities, I'll help out as much as I can, right? But since there aren't any questions yet, what I did since we did the last stream this morning, I put some took some data that I want to look at, okay? And I thought maybe I'll present this data in table format for you guys to take a look at. And let me tell you what this data is. And this is something we'll dig in a little bit further. But this is the data of my gaming group, okay? Our gaming group. We have basically six core people in our gaming group. One of them is away right now. One of them shows up randomly, not very often. They got other commitments and stuff. So there's about five of us that are core gaming group, and there's about three or four different floaters that come and go, right? Depending on what game we're playing. But the data I have right now is for the Monopoly games that we've been playing. And if you recall, we put out a video on alternate rules of how to play Monopoly, right? Quick short versions where we deal out the cards and make deals and stuff like that. I should have actually made the video available. Here, let me do a link on it. Chicho Monopoly. Chicho. Let's see if that shows up. There it is. So I'm gonna post the link here. Oop, let me stop this so the sound doesn't come through. Grab this guy. So here's the video I'm talking about. Okay. That's the video we put together on alternate rules for Monopoly and how we play in our gaming group. And since putting out that video, I think within a week or something, we started collecting data, keeping track of who was winning what. Okay, how many games we played and stuff. So let me put down this data. And this is something I plan on doing a little bit of crunching on, just doing ratios, percentages, and stuff like this. So, I got one, two, three, four, five, six columns here, right? But I'll crunch these numbers more, do percentages. But I thought I'd present this data to you just in case you're curious of what we're collecting right now. And then what we'll do in a future video, take a look at this data and see what they tell us very quickly. And then what I want to do is share with you another version of Monopoly we've been playing. So we've been basically playing this version a lot because it's very fast and it's not taxing. And then we've been playing basically the ratio is about 2 to 4 games of this version versus this version versus the other version that I haven't shared with you how we're playing it. And we sort of introduced it after playing this version a bit. One of the regulars in our gaming group came up and said, "Hey, this version we can play," and we modified it a little bit and we've been experimenting with a little bit, and it's fantastic and it's taxing. It's like after you finish this new version that we're playing, you're exhausted, right? So it's fun coming back to this version because these are more rapid games and it doesn't have that element where you're like on the edge of your seat trying to bluff somebody out, right? But I'll share the instructions for that version later on during the summer, probably next month or so. Okay, but here's the data. Here's the wins and losses for the different number of people who've been coming to our game, to our Monopoly nights. Okay, so let me write this down for you, just in case you're curious. This is like random math, I guess. And if there's any questions coming up, if anybody wants to do a little bit of mathematics, post a question and we'll talk about it, okay? And let me change the angle. Boop. So let me put this stuff up here. Let me take off my glasses. This is the data so far, okay? This is how the results have come out so far, okay? Now, NA is one of the people in our gaming group. Chicho is me. Chicho, don't forget the O. VG is another person. VE is another person. Okay. LI is another person. And ZZ is another person. Okay. So we got six people in our sort of gaming group for Monopoly. Okay. And the top five are the ones that show up a lot. Okay. And this is the results we have so far. The number of wins, let's put the number of wins first. Wins. Let's go losses. Oops. I better start with an L for losses, right? Hopefully we can fit it all in, right? I want to fit it all in. Losses. The total would just be this plus this, right? Total. And then we have single games. Single, double. Okay. And we'll put the points here. Okay, I'm gonna put this a little tighter so we fit everything in. Let's move these guys over too. Okay. And let's make Chicho a little bit smaller. Tighter. So we have win, loss, total number of games played. We got single games. We got double games. Okay. And we got total number of points. And let's draw a line. Let's do this. Okay. Let's see. Okay, no commas, no math wanting to be done. So let's do this. Let me show you this data. Wins, losses, total, single games, double games, and the total number of points. Okay. So NA has won 14 total games and lost 57. Okay. And number of wins plus the number of losses equals the total number of games. So that's going to be 71 games, right? 4 plus 7 is 1. 11, you get 1, you put 1 there. So 71 games total. Okay. From the 14 wins, 13 of them were single wins, one of them was a double win. Okay. So 13 single win, one double game. Okay. And a double game counts as 2 points. So let me write down the double and then point. Let's put double and then put in bracket points. Okay. Now, if we give singles 1 point, double games, we're going to make them 2 points, right? So number of double games is one. Okay. That means they have 2 points. Okay. So the total number of points that they have is 13 plus 2 is 15. For Chicho, I'm kicking ass. If you turn out you have won the most games, I'm going to think this data is rigged. I've won the most games. Right? I've won 21 games, right? I've played 50 games, or sorry, I've won 21 games, I've lost 50 games, and if you add those up, 71 games. So me and NA have played the total number, the same number of games, right? Out of the 21 games that I've won, okay, 10 of them have been single games and 11 have been double games, right? 11 have been double games, and that's 22 points, right? So I have a total of 10 plus 22 is 32 points, right? We still haven't figured out why I'm winning so many double games, right? NA is pointing that out a lot. Okay. VG has won 6 games, has lost 32 games, so played 38 games. Okay. And from the eight, from the 6 wins, they have 4 single wins and 2 double games, which is a total of 4. So they got 8 points total. VE has won 19 games, 49 losses, right? So they've played 68 games, just three less than me in NA, right? 14 of these games, 14 out of 19 have been single games, and 5 have been double games. 5 have been double games, so that's 10 points. So that becomes 14 plus 10 is 24 points. Okay. LI has won 10 games, played 32, right? So that's 42 total games. And from the 10 wins, 8 have been singles and 2 are doubles, which is 4 points. So 8 plus 4 is 12 points. And ZZ, they haven't shown up to too many games. They're busy, right? Family and whatnot, and out of town a lot. So they've won one game, played seven. Sorry, lost seven, so total of 8 games. So they have 1 single point, 0 doubles, so they're sitting at 1 point. Okay. And from this data, I plan on doing a little bit of crunching. Okay. Just percentages, right? Basically, I wanna show base, take the number of points divided by, can we figure out how many double games there have been? I guess so. This would be the total double games we've played, right? Sorry, this would be the total double games we've played, right? So if you total up these columns, you can do a total across the board, really, right? Go across and do total. For some of these, the total won't make sense. Like the total number of games, this won't make sense really, right? Because the total number of games we've played, the maximum is 71. But you could definitely tally up the totals for the doubles, right? That's how many double games we've played, right? So total number of double games we've played is 5. So that's 9, 20, 21 double games we've played. And how many single games? A few single games. And this plus this should equal 71. So let's check it out. Can we group these things together? We can't group from 9. 9 plus 10 is 19. 29. 20, 29 and 8. 37. Oh, did I add up that one? Okay, let's do this again. That's 30. 30. 37, 41, right? 30, 37, 41, 41, mind mush, 41 and 50. So this is 50, yeah. So that's got to be 50. 50 plus 21 is 50, 71 games, right? That's the total number of games we've played. And then we can tally up the totals and stuff like this. So we can do divisions, right? We can take the total number of points and then figure out what the total points is. Right, so this would be 42, and do the division, add those guys up, and figure out how much of the points, percents or points I've gotten, what percentage of the games I've won, and stuff like this, or NA or VA or whatever it is, right? How many games people have missed. Do a ratio relative to how many games they've played is probably a better ratio, right? You could do 21 divided by 71. That's the win ratio, right? Win percentages. Because VE hasn't played as many games, LI hasn't played as many games. So we could see, if LI's percentage of wins is equivalent to my percentage of wins, right? Or this percentage of wins. So that's just the data, and that's the type of data we can collect, right? Fun. It was fun looking at this stuff. And we're going to do another serious round of games next week, I believe, as well. I think there are people available, and for the summer they might be taking off, so we're going to try to get as many games as we can in the next couple of weeks.
Okay.
Fun stuff. Very fun game to play. Very fun game to play. It's definitely not rigged, though. It's definitely not rigged. For a time, I actually had a my ratio of wins to games played was better than what it is right now. I just, because there's deal making being made in the game, I had people trying to make sure that I didn't win the game. And then when things started balancing out, so whenever somebody was getting a lot of games, the other people were sort of trying to maneuver themselves. They were more lenient in the deal making within themselves than they were with the person racking up the points, right? So it sort of balances out. But it was fun, and this is the type of data you can collect, right? When it comes to playing games or any type of statistics. So we'll try to do some stats on that thing at some point anyway, at some point anyway. Fun. That's the math sort of. I wanted to show you guys the type of data that we can take a look at, right? Teaming up on you. And actually, at this point, here, let me show you this. For VE, okay, there was two nights that we ended up playing, and VE basically won every game we played except for like two of them. So we played a total of like, I don't know, in two nights. In a good night, we end up playing like, in an 8 hour session, we would play at least like 8 or 9 games, right? So in a two night period, VE ended up winning almost everything except like two or three games, and all of a sudden the rest of us were sort of maneuvering, trying to prevent VE from taking all the games. Okay, so VE was way behind until last month, I guess. And then all of a sudden, within 2 days, they went up to number two. They caught up to me, right? So it was pretty cool. It was pretty cool seeing it happen. Was fun. I'm guessing by next year, when we do these math open discussions, we're gonna have more people popping in, taking advantage of having math help, right? Hopefully anyway. But I definitely want to make myself available for this. And the timing is wacko. And I know I'm sort of doing it all day, and the reason I'm doing it all day is because people live in different time zones and stuff. And by the way, I mentioned the last stream that I loaded on. I was gonna let loose the how to read a textbook. Sorry, how to take notes video that we did the behind the scenes of, and I let that loose on YouTube and BitChute just before the stream started. So if you want to take a look at how I end up taking notes and whatnot, you can take a look at that. Let me here. I'll provide a link to. It's the main video on my channel right now. The last one that I loaded. It took a while to get that done. It was crazy. Here's the boop. Here's the link to that video. Okay. And I called it basically how to take notes, ASMR math, how to study tip number 7. Okay. Aside from that, I really don't want to do any math lessons. I'd rather just keep it open if anyone pops by. And since no one's come up with any math questions, and I've done the math that I wanted to take a look at, the data I wanted to take a look at, how familiar are you with options pricing? I'd like to hear your take through the Black-Scholes. Oh, I don't know the Black-Scholes model. I might have read this a long time ago. The last time I did options trading was 18 years ago. Okay, I did a fair bit of maybe you could look it up at some point. Sure, I'd be into looking it up. And there, I've been so tempted to dive back into, I'm just going to the wiki page, dive back into the options trading game, because I believe, in my opinion, we're in a complete bubble in many different fields, many different disciplines. So options is a good way to cash out on some of that stuff. The Black-Scholes or Black-Scholes Merton model is a mathematical model for the dynamics of a financial market containing derivatives, investments, instruments from the differential equations in the model known as the Black-Scholes equations. One can deduce the Black-Scholes formula, which gives a theoretical estimate of the price of the European style options. And show, oh, I don't know. I just traded mainly Canada and United States options. I didn't do any European. I didn't realize there was a difference between them. And shows that the options have a unique price regardless of the risk of the security and its expected return. Really? They must take the VIX into consideration. The formula led to the boom in options trading and provided mathematical legitimacy to the activities of the Chicago Board of Options Exchange and other options markets around the world. It is widely used, although often with adjustments and correlations by options market participants. Really, so it's basically fine-tuned. It's a good base where you can start off from and then start playing around with it. Cool. I'll bookmark this. Model. Do this. Options trading. Math. Blink. Cool. Thanks for that index. When I get a chance, I'll look into it. I'll put it in my queue anyway. Here, I'll pin this as well. That way I'll take another look at it as well. Yeah, it's been the standard pricing model since the 60s. That's what index is saying. Index says, I don't know how it works, but we rely on it. Yeah, the options trading is... there's a lot of... I don't want to say scams, but there's a lot of manipulation in options trading. Lots of manipulation in options trading. So if you're not careful, you can get seriously burned with them. But the best thing, the way I used to do options trading and the way I would do options trading again if I was to get back into it, or trading stocks in general, maybe cryptos or not, right? I would basically take five companies, follow them, and look at the way the options were being priced. Maybe be puts or calls, right? I would look both directions and take a look at how they're being priced. And if I was going to go long or short, right, buy calls or puts, what I would do, I would stagger them. And I'm pretty sure this might be normal method of doing things, but I would do within a few weeks out, right, up to a month, and then 3 months, and then 6 months. And then if I thought I might have been too early in the game for a rise or a dip, I would buy a year out options. I would pay the price for the term, the length of the option being longer, right? So I forget all the terminology, my apologies by the way, but I would pay that price, right, the premium for buying the puts or calls on a long-term basis. And then I wouldn't hold out the options. I held some options to the end. I have. It's part of the game. Sometimes you're stubborn, you know it's supposed to go up or down by a certain time and it just doesn't, right? Sometimes you double up, triple up just a day or two before an option expires just to average down. So if you get a hit, you get a certain return. You're not just getting back your money or less than your money. You're doubling up, tripling up, quadrupling up, 10 times enough depending on a day before, right? So usually you don't want to hold on to the option until expiry date, but that's the way I usually played it. I didn't follow any model. I followed I did follow some models. I shouldn't say that. I did follow some models, but I would stick to five, and I would have like 20 stocks that I followed in my basket and in a serious way. And then I would, if I thought the price was juicy enough to go in with puts or calls, I would jump in. Okay. I primarily write options. I take the other side of your trade. Okay, cool. The writing options, for those that want to know, is basically, hopefully you're not writing naked. You're not, you have the stocks as well. So one type of sort of money generating that a lot of funds and people do is they buy certain stock, right? Preferably a stock that doesn't move as much. It's Delta is fairly stable, right? And Delta is how, I believe so anyway, I keep on forgetting names, how fast the price of a stock is moving, right? So if a stock price is doing this, let's say it's moving up or staying stable, what people end up doing is you can write calls. That means sell calls that you don't have. Sell this asset class, which is sort of a option to buy stocks on a ratio of 1 to 10 or 1 to 100 or whatever it is, right? You buy these things based on the price of the original stock, right? You write these off, you sell them. Now, if the stock stays here, then there's a time limit associated with this thing. What happens is when the time limit hits, you've cashed in, you've made money. If the stock goes up and stays at that price, you've still made money. If the stock goes above the price, right, then what's happening is you got to pay the difference, and you can play the game both on the up and on the down. And that's what index is saying. They're basically writing, I believe so anyway, I primarily write options. Write options, which is writing puts or writing calls, right? You can write puts as well. If the stock's going up, just keep on selling the puts, assuming that the stock doesn't go down. And it's a dangerous game if you're not holding the equivalent of the options that you're selling. If a stock gets away from you on the upside, or it gets away from you on the downside, then you have to cover that distance. Writing a contract to give someone the obligation to buy or sell, correct? Yeah, that's what it is. Okay. And it's interesting, but I'm pretty sure index will confirm this. Yeah, you have to be on the ball when you do options trading, when you're shorting, when you're writing calls and puts. You can't be, it can't be, you know, something you look at on a weekly basis. You have to keep track of this stuff daily if you're writing puts or calls close to the expiration date, right? And if they're very close, you have to be watching it multiple times during the day. Very careful. It has a 10 to 1 leverage, not like stocks at 2 to 1. Yeah. So 10 to 1 means one option, one put or call controls 10 shares of something, right? So you're basically, it's sort of like based on fractional reserve accounting, right? But fractional reserve is 1 to 100, right? So if you have $1, you can lend out $100, right? Based on the rules of our centralized government. Oh, 100 shares. One option, yeah, one option controls 100 shares. It should be, that's right. So it is basically like, yeah, it is basically like fractional reserve banking, right? $1 controls $100, one put controls 100 shares, or one put call controls 100 shares, right? I should look this up again. It was fun doing it, and you could make some good money. You could, if you're into that, if you wanna gamble or whatnot. But basically, to a certain degree, cryptocurrencies have taken a fair bit of the trading game as well. Not as much as Wall Street and stuff like this, but if they persist, it will be part of the regular routine. And it's just like any asset class, really. You can buy and sell comic books, right? Which is interesting. It's a great way to learn how our present economic system works, really. It's a very interesting way to learn how the present economic system works. And that's it. Interesting. I'll look into it index. Well, I can't promise when, but at some point we'll definitely play around with it. Okay. Doesn't look like anybody wants to do any mathematics. Should I show you some of the comics I've been reading recently? Sure, no worries. Cool. Should I show you some of the comics I've been reading recently? The comic book people are gonna be pissed if I'm showing this right now. But I figured, since some people came on and said they already wrote some of their exams, that means the number of people coming on here to ask math questions is gonna decrease. Okay, let's do it. Look at this. Stack of now this is related to the comic books. I showed that I this isn't all the comic books I've been reading, but this is the comic books I've been reading that are just sort of floaters that what do you call it, that I have just kicking around that I'm picking up very cheap, right? They're either free comic book day comic books, or I'm buying them for a dollar or whatever it might be, right? So they're basically stuff that I get on the cheap, so I'm not bagging and boarding them. I know this is like a no-no, but I do like going doing this every now and then, right? And this is basically the video. Where is the video? Let me show you the video. I don't know if it'll be one of the top ones, but basically it was me showing you guys the comic books I've been reading for the last little while, continuation from that. Where was it? Where was it? A live stream discussion system without first that announcement. Comic books I'm pulling. Here we go. Cool. That's this one. Let me show you this. And in this one, I basically. Check this out. In this one, I basically showed you guys a whole bunch of stacks of comics I've been reading and reading, like there's just floppies like this, right? And I'll give you a review of some of them. This one was free comic book day from Aspen Comics. Check this out. Okay, and this was great read. I was really surprised. I've read some Aspen comics and I've seen some of their stuff, but I really haven't read too many of their stories. But this was very good. It was sort of a compilation intro of three different stories, and it was very good. It had, fantasy associated with it and a little bit of post-apocalyptic stuff, which I enjoyed. I read this one, True Believers, first appearance of Carol Danvers, Marvel Girl, and it was fun. It was a fun read. I keep on forgetting how much reading content the comic books of old used to have. They're much longer reads, so it's nice having them. This was free comic book day, 2080. This was fantastic. I love British comics. Are you going to board them, or are you not worried about them? These ones I'm not worried. I'm not going to be bored in these ones. These I have some stuff that I treated like this, and their prices have gone up, and then I board and bag them afterwards. And usually, if I have something like this, it means I already have another copy, or it means they're free comic book day stuff, or it means, they're True Believers or Image $1 ones or DC one or Valiant $1 ones, right? I wish every publisher did this, released $1 comics. So there's a lot of comic book, free comic book day stuff. There's a lot of $1 stuff, but I'm not gonna bag and board these because sometimes I have friends come over and they say, "What, give me some comics to read, give me some," and I just grab a stack of these and put them in front of them and say, "Take your pick, read," right? And that way I don't have to say, "Listen, give them a comic and a bag and board," and say, "Listen, be careful with this, don't wrinkle it up, don't do this to it, don't do that to it," right? This way, there's floaters around that people can read. And this is the way I treat these, and I keep all of these. Okay, I don't throw this stuff away. This stays with me, right? So this was really good. I love British comic books, British writers and stuff. Yeah, that's not the best way to get people into comics. No, it's not. I've tried before. I give them, some people have wanted to read, Death of Superman or Death of Superman is not that expensive, but it was important to me at the time, right? Or they wanted to read the first appearance of Deadpool, right? Handing them a comic book that's worth like, and New Mutants 98, that's worth like $300, $400 and say, be careful with this. Like, dude, keep it. I don't want to read it, right? What's your most expensive comic? I don't know. I don't know. As far as I'm concerned, I have some comics that I wouldn't sell for what they're selling for right now. Read this one, Wolverine, 90s Wolverine, right? It was a fun read. It's so intense, so dramatic, right? And with 90s artwork, fun read, okay. As for the most expensive, I showed you the Mystic number 6 that I picked out, the CGC graded, that was at 5.5 or something like this. As far as I'm concerned, that's one of the most expensive ones, and I only paid $71 for it. Is it your Jackie Gleason? Jackie Gleason for sure, man. That Jackie Gleason, I paid, I don't know what I paid for it. I can't remember. It was less than 100 that I paid for it. But I saw CGC one, CGC 7.0 sell for $130, and at the time I was tapped out. I couldn't buy it, right? I didn't bid on it. That's one of the regrets I have. I wish I had bought that Jackie Gleason CGC graded at 7. That was like the third highest graded. There was only like 7 of them graded, right? So the Jackie Gleason for sure, but that's very specialized. There aren't too many people that would bid up on that. This was fantastic. I love the 90s Silver Surfer. Okay, this was sort of Thanos coming back, appearing again with death in there and stuff. Fantastic read. Okay. And that's the cover for it too. That was Silver Surfer 34. Okay, that's the main cover. Another one that would be on the expensive side would definitely be Daredevil number 1 that I have, that we did the reading for sure. This was okay read. This is from SBI Press. It was generic. Free comic book day. Okay. Some of the other more expensive stuff I have is the EC comics that I have. They're not in great shape, but they're special to me. The Tick Free Comic Book Day. This was fun read. I like the Tick. I pick it up every now and then and read. Right? It's not as great as the original, but it was good. Secret Empire, Underground number 1. They go to the Lost World, I guess, in the Arctic. It was generic for me. I could take it or leave it. It was just a random read. Afar by Image Comics. This one, sort of Image first. The story had promise, the artwork was lacking for my taste. It was okay. It didn't interest me, intrigue me enough to continue reading it. Okay. I'm a musicology student, and one of my musicology friends is studying comic book sound and their history. Oh, really? Oh, that's cool. Are they doing like a thesis on it as well? Where do you have all your comics? They're just in boxes, bags and boards, boxes, multiple boxes, a lot of boxes. There's a period where I showed the number of boxes I had, right? When I was doing the move, I did a video with all the boxes in the background and I showed you guys how I store my comic books. Yeah, it's fascinating. Yeah, and if they make the dissertation available online, your friend, after they do it, I'm assuming this is grad studies. If they make it available online, if you remember, send me a link. I'd like to take a look at it. Do you have some big list where everything is? Nope. Mine is random. There are certain parts. I used to go to trade shows and I had a table where I was selling comics, so some of that stuff was organized. But then throughout the years, I've moved things, rearranged boxes and stuff like this. So it's all randomized. Like, if someone came up to me right now and says, where's New Mutants 98? I would go, I don't know. Maybe have a general idea of where it might be. I don't know though, because I move things around. Yeah. Okay, cool. Awesome. Yeah, for sure. Send me a link. This was okay. The Star Wars thing, not my cup of tea. I'm not really. I know some people are enjoying the Star Wars books. I've read a handful of them. It doesn't really intrigue me that much anymore because it's got the Disney filter on it. You should write on the boxes. I used to, when I was doing trade shows, I would write, but during moves, I try to condense stuff, so I would put things in boxes, put them together. One thing I've promised myself for my next move into maybe a permanent place, if it happens, I will organize the comics. And if we end up doing that, we'll do that live stream and I'll show you as much as I can anyway. Kid Savage, free comic book day. This was sort of reminded me of Savage from Valiant Comics. It was okay. It's G rated. Okay. And this is from who's the company? Oh, this is Image. This is from Image Comics. Not my cup of tea. Okay. Injustice. This was sort of a, I guess, free comic book day thing that we're giving out. I read the original Injustice. I don't think I've read all of it, and I liked it. This was along the same lines, but not as good. Shadow Ro Roads. This guy, this intrigued me. This is from Oni Press. Okay, again, free comic book day, and it did intrigue me. I don't think I haven't added it to my pull list, and I don't think I will. But if I see it, if I feel like a random buy, I might do it. Okay. Wolverine, Bloodhunger. Fun read. It's a Marvel reprint. Okay. And it was a good read. It wasn't bad. I liked it. Right. And this was from Marvel Comics Presents. It was from these pages, and it was Sam Keith. I believe it's Sam Keith. It should be Sam Keith. Yeah, Sam Keith. Peter David doing the writing and Sam Keith doing the artwork. And I like Sam Keith. Right. That was a fun read. It was very good. Okay. It was good. This one again, True Believers, and this was Wolverine 10, I believe. Reprint of it, yeah. This is the original cover, Wolverine 10, from the first continuing series. And this was the True Believers cover on it. And I read this back in the day when it came out, and it was fun. It wasn't bad. The artwork was so-so. The artwork was. It wasn't bad. It was classic, 80s, 90s style of artwork. Fool Killer number one. Not a bad read. Not a bad read at all. Okay. At a different time, I would pick it up and read a little bit more. But right now, I've got my plate full. So, not a bad read. Wolverine versus Venom, True Believers. Okay. It was okay. It was, well, I don't know. It didn't really. This is the original cover for it. Okay. It was very scattered. I wouldn't pick it up. I wouldn't read it again. It was, the artwork was okay, but the story just jumped all over the place. Really. It was like you didn't know what was going on and why it was happening. So, I guess this would be the first. True Believers, Wolverine Brothers. Okay. And this is, I don't know what this was, but I hadn't read this before, but it was a good story and it's going to continue. It was more mature, and I liked it. It was a good read. Okay, this I would recommend. Free Comic Book Day, Shadow Man. Right? And this kicks off, I believe, into Shadow Man number one, the new series that came out. And it was good. I didn't mind it. It also has Exo in it, you know, sort of Exo going back to Earth, and it was good. I like my Valiants, so the Free Comic Book Day stuff I definitely pick up. And this is Harbinger Wars 2. And this beginning part is this type of stuff they do with the people with abilities to read people's minds. They like doing this. They've done this a couple other times too, where they have the person in the crowd walking the streets and they're posting all the different thoughts that people are having, conversations. Chicho, can you think of any stream of consciousness style comic that might be worth reading? Consciousness style comics. Consciousness style comics. Are you talking about like, what's your favorite one-shot comic? I loved Death of Harbinger, Book of Death, Death of Bloodshot, and Death of Harbinger. Those were fantastic standalone reads, really. For recent, anyway, that I've read in the last, I guess, 8 years or so. So, Book of Death, Fall of Bloodshot, and Book of Death, Fall of Harbinger. And they put two other ones, Book of Death, Fall of Ninjak, Book of Death, Fall of Exo. But Book of Death, Fall of Harbinger, and Fall of Bloodshot, they were very good. If you know the characters, they were fantastic standalone reads. Okay. Aside from that, Sky Doll, it came out as a two-issue series. It was just two issues, and it's a continuation from other stuff that they've done. It's an Italian, I believe they're Italian creators, and it's a translation into English. And Sky Doll was very, very good. Beautiful artwork, absolutely phenomenal artwork, right? I love the trade paperback, the Andre the Giant bibliography, and I love the Andy Kaufman bibliography that I read. But they're not single issues, they're trade paperbacks, but that's the only way to print it. Aside from that, single issues, single issues. If others come to mind, I'll let you know. But and some of the best single issues I've read are from Savage Sword of Conan, the magazine. Phenomenal comics, phenomenal series, very underrated. And at some point, I plan on buying the whole collection. I plan on having the whole thing because I haven't read everything in that. Okay. Oh, the consciousness style comic. Consciousness style comic. Can you narrow it down for me? Like, are we talking about altered states of being? Are we talking about looking into meditation? Like Sandman definitely goes into alternate states of being. Not alternate states of being, but alternate realities. But there's a lot of that in comic books specifically, right? Going to different universes, different timelines, all the different possibilities. Anything that was enlightening, that gave me wow moments. Some of them might be corny. Like one of the ones that did it for me, I think one of the best crossovers in comic books is Valiance in the 1990s when they did the Unity. And one of the things they kept on saying was like Frank Herbert's a mantra in Dune, where I don't know how many times in Frank Herbert's Dune they said, fear is the mind killer, fear is the mind killer, fear is the mind killer, fear is the mind killer. And you read that so many times that it embedded itself into your conscious, subconscious, right? And it made itself into, for me anyway, into my living conscious, where I realized, yes, fear is the mind killer. Do not fear, right? One of the things that the Valiance Unity did in the 90s for me, one of the mantras they had in that crossover, which was 18 issues, from what I recall anyway, it was that time is not absolute. Time is not absolute, time is not absolute, time is not absolute. all of a sudden that made it into my conscience saying that time is not absolute. No one says that time has to. And knowing physics and mathematics, looking at this further, no one really has to say that time absolute basically changes at the same rate throughout history or prehistory, right? And that's one of the where I connected that. That was one of the things that assumptions associated with every type of science has certain types of assumptions where they use mathematics to present ideas, right? One of the laws in geology, in earth sciences, is the law of uniformitalism. Brutalizing the pronunciation, but basically says that time was, or the rate of change of things was absolute. Basically, the rate of change of things that we see now in the geological realm was the same rate that other things, that's the same rate that things occurred in the past. But time is governed by gravity and acceleration, and if gravity and acceleration change, then time changes at a different rate. So, you know, that brought those into consideration and just seeds planting to question ideas and stuff. Stream of consciousness is a literally device. Oh, is it? Okay. A way of writing that is very off the top of the head, like James Joyce. I give the reader access to the subjective experience, the inner monologue. Oh, stream of consciousness is a literary device, a way of writing that is very off the top of the head. Let me look this up a little bit more. Is literary criticism stream of consciousness a narrative mode or method that attempts to depict the tumultuous thoughts and feelings which pass through the mind? The term was coined by William. Oh, you know what? Then I would say Claremont, Chris Claremont's X-Men in the early days, and I had a conversation with a comic book, a comic shop owner last week, and I mentioned that I like Chris Claremont's Excalibur, and he was like, "Oh, are you feeling good?" I'm like, "Oh, you don't like Chris Claremont's Excalibur?" He goes, he didn't like Chris Claremont at all because it was John Burns. He told me a little bit of history on this, and that sort of shattered my thing of Chris Claremont. I still love Chris Claremont's work, but basically he mentioned that John Burns was doing a lot of the writing for the early X-Men where Chris Claremont is credited because Chris Claremont and John Burns were writing together and they both have egos, and they wrote a number of dozens of issues of X-Men from the early 100s all the way to the mid 100s. And some of that stuff is brilliant because there's a lot of internal dialogue going on for the characters. Okay. So Chris Claremont stuff, X-Men, there is a fair bit of that. I'll keep an eye out. I'll try to keep this in mind. So internal dialogue saying, sort of expressing the character's belief of what's happening and stuff like that. Valiant is good for that as well, especially stuff done with Harbinger, and especially actually, I believe if I recall correctly, Fallout Bloodshot maybe in that tone. I can't remember exactly. Inner monologue. Oh, fascinating. I'll have to do things. Yeah, please do. I'll keep that in mind, Index. Seriously, I know I've read a fair bit like that. A lot of comics like that. They're just not popping up to me because I haven't categorized them in that form, in my mind, right? So definitely I'll think about this. That's good question. Now, seriously curious. Maybe I'll do a little search at some point. Now you'll notice it more often. For sure, I'll notice it more often. One of the things, that wasn't internal dialogue though. When I showed you guys the comic books where we read classic X-Men, the dialogue that was being presented on the first page with Jean Grey, what she was going through looking at a bonfire and how she could look into the atomic structure of the fire and how that was crackling and fizzling and how the subatomic particles were interacting together. I thought that was brilliant, but I don't think that was an internal monologue. That was more of a description of third person, possibly, I believe. But I'll keep it in mind for sure. I'll keep it in mind for sure. So that's about an hour that we just did, and we have this many comic books to go through still. So how about we look at these ones? I'll give you a review of these ones in the next stream, starting at 2:30. Is that okay? I hope so. Unless there's any math questions that people have, right? I don't think I'll put together a math lesson for anything today. We've got two more streams going on for math at 2:30 and 4:30, I believe, right? Oh, sorry, at 2 o'clock and 4:30. Yeah, not 2:30. At 2 o'clock, I believe, and then at 4:30, the event page lists them. Okay, so maybe what we'll do in the 2 o'clock session is, if there's no math questions and I haven't looked up anything that I want to share regarding mathematics, we'll start off with this and wait for people to come up with questions regarding mathematics. Otherwise, we'll talk comic books if you like, or anything else if you like. I hope that's okay. I hope you guys are okay with doing a day of streams. I do like this. I want to make myself available to you guys for any Q&A and stuff like that. That's one thing I promise to do, and I will definitely try to stick to my promises. Okay, sounds good. Sounds good, man. I'll see you guys, I guess, in an hour and a half. Okay, and I'll wait a few minutes before going through this other set of comics, the rest of them. Okay, hope you guys have a good little lunch break, my time anyway, and evening break, your time if you're having it, or morning if you're having it. Okay, we'll talk in a bit. Bye for now.